Slaughter, and I'd like to welcome you to Saddle Ridge Ranch, Lifeway's premier vacation Bible school destination. When we got to working on ideas for this theme, we decided to ask kids some questions that they had about life. And these are some of the ones they asked the most.
Who am I?
If I could ask God one question, it would be, does God care about me?
What is God's plan for me?
How could I be like Jesus?
What do I do now?
These are things that kids are really wondering about. And with Saddle Ridge Ranch VBS, you can help them find the answers in God's Word. So what are you waiting on? Come on, grab your hat and your boots, saddle up your horse. We got a lot of ground to cover.
Well, amen. Vacation Bible School is coming soon, so we're going to need a lot of help with that. We're so glad to have you here this morning. Amen. Are you glad to be here? This service is going to be a very, very, very special service. In a little while, we're going to recognize our seniors. But God is an awesome God. Amen. And we are grateful to be here in this worship service, and it's a happy day. Would you stand up? We want you to put your hands together with us. Come on. Come on, church. Help us out today. Come on. All right, if you don't know this song, listen to the first verse and sing with us.
Greatest day in history, death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won today. Shout it out, Jesus is alive.
Would you please be seated? Our amped students choir is going to lead on this next song.
Thank you.
Amen. That's our AMP student choir, and I tell you what, I'm so proud of them. Also, my wife directs them, by the way. I'm really glad that that too. Thank you, Amy. Tonight, you will not want to miss what's going on in this room at 6 o'clock. The AMP student choir will be performing a thing called Glimpses, and there's going to be all kinds of wonderful Broadway songs that you've known in the past. They're going to be doing some costume changes. They're going to do some of those kinds of songs tonight as well. You will not want to miss tonight, 6 o'clock. Trust me, you'll enjoy it, all right? Well, we're glad you're here. If you would, do me a favor. As you came in today, you should have gotten the supersized worship guide. Wave it at me. Let me know that you got it, all right? Everybody kind of awake. You got it? Excellent. Thank you very much. As you came in, look at that worship guide, and please do me a favor. You'll see that little side flap on the inside of there. We'd like every single person in this room, whether you are a first-time guest or founding member, we want you to rip that side panel off of there. We want you to look at some of the lines down there toward the bottom of the page. And this is for prayer requests. If you'd like for our church and our church staff to partner with you about a prayer request, we'd absolutely love to do that. You can fill that out on the lines right there. We've got a few more weeks before the summertime comes of Wednesday night suppers. We have some incredible meals and classes going here on Wednesday nights. If you'd like to be a part of that, you can let us know on that as well. So please do me a favor, fill that out. When the offering comes by a little bit later on in the service, put that in the offering plate. That helps us to know you a little better and how to meet your needs, okay? We're thrilled that you're here. One of the things that we like to do right at the top of the service is have everybody stand and greet each other. So would you just stand up right now, turn around, find somebody, shake their hands. Come on, let's greet each other today.
Good morning. We've got something special that we are going to do this morning. So if you guys would have a seat, we do this every year. My name is Joel Oates. I am the youth pastor here, and I've had the privilege of working with many of your students for the past couple years. And every year we get the privilege of honoring some of these students who have made it, who have made it through. And I know some bumps and bruises along the way, but it is definitely an honor and a privilege to honor our graduating seniors and graduating college graduates this morning. So without further ado, we will begin our ceremony. Our first senior this morning is Zachary Ty Beck. He is graduating. From Olympia High School, and his future plans are going to Valencia and then transfer to USF for his BA. He is the son of Mr. and Mrs. Todd and Melanie Beck. Our second senior this morning is Mr. Justin Bickerstaff. Son of John and Melissa Bickerstaff. He is graduating from West Orange High School and planning on attending UNC. He's going to be a Tar Heel, ladies and gentlemen. Our next senior is Caroline Rose Chomanix. She is the daughter of Dave and Colleen Chomanix, and she is graduating from Olympia High School and planning on attending AMDA. Our next graduate is James Joseph Ellison. James is the son of Jeff and Crystal Ellison, and he is graduating Foundation Academy this year and attending UCF starting in the fall. Our next graduate is Sammy Fleck. Daughter of Carrie and Peter Fleck, She is graduating from Olympia High School. She is the president of the senior class, and her plans are attending FAU in the fall. Our first college graduate, Miss Amy Goins. Daughter of Ron and Jenny Goins, she has graduated from Liberty University with a degree in psychology. Our next graduate is Abigail Paige Griffith. She is the daughter of Doug and Lisa Griffith. She is graduating from West Orange High School, and her plans are completing cosmetology program at Westside Tech. Our next graduate is Mr. Jordan Harvey. Son of Forrest and Lynn Harvey. He's graduating from West Orange High School and attending Valencia for sound engineering in the fall. Our next graduate is Miss Jordan Marshall. Jordan, the daughter of Stuart and Teresa Marshall, is graduating from Olympia High School and planning on attending FSU in the fall. Wesley David Murray is our next graduate. He is the son of David and Mary Ellen Murray. He is graduating from Foundation Academy and attending Charleston Southern. I love it. Charleston Southern in the fall. You get a big gift afterward. Okay. Our next senior is Miss Courtney Noble. Daughter of Dee Dee and Todd Noble, she is graduating from Foundation Academy and then attending Lake Sumter Community College in the fall. Our next graduate, a famous last name, Mr. Brady Schmidt. You get a bigger gift too. All right, son of Troy and Barbie Schmidt, he is graduating Olympia High School and attending FSU in the fall. Our next senior is Mr. Scott Simmons. Son of Tom and Danae Simmons, he is graduating from the First Academy and planning on attending Southern Methodist University in the fall. Our next graduate, Mr. Aaron Hammond Sprague. He is the son of Scott and Ann Sprague. He is graduating from West Orange High School and he is currently undecided on the college he is looking to attend in the fall. Our next graduate, Miss Julianne Steiner. Daughter of Kurt and Heidi Steiner, she is graduating from Dr. Phillips High School and plans on attending a Valencia to the International Academy of Design and Technology in the fall. Our next graduate, Mr. John Stevens. Parents Carol Miller, Jess, and Chantel Stevens. He is graduating from Osceola County School of Arts and is planning on attending FSU in the fall. Woo! Our next graduate, Mr. James Sweeting IV. Parents of James and Donna Sweeting. He is graduating from West Orange High School and planning on majoring in business at Valencia in the fall. Our next graduate is Mr. Cameron Tanner. Son of Scott and Michelle Tanner. He is graduating from West Orange High School and then attending Valencia and UCF for physical therapy starting in the fall. Our last graduate this morning is Miss Taylor Wilson. Daughter of Scott and Julie Wilson. She is graduating from West Orange High School and plans on attending the University of Central Florida for med school starting in the fall. Ladies and gentlemen, your graduates of 2010. Let's hear it for this amazing accomplishment. And let's give the parents and grandparents a round of applause for what they did to get them here. Directly following, we do have a graduate kind of luncheon for the families and grandparents, just so you know, and we want to honor them a little bit further during that time. So thank you so much, and we'll hand it back over.
Let's pray for our graduates, okay? Father, I thank you so much for who you are today. Just thank you for these wonderful seniors, Father Lord, and just thank you for the way that you've blessed them, the way that you've blessed their parents, the way that you've just provided for them today, Father Lord, because we know things can be difficult throughout these years, and just thank you for what you're doing in their lives today. May, Father Lord, as they go to college, Father Lord, I pray that they would not forget you, would not forget your ways, and they would stay strong in your word and stay strong to Christ. We just thank you for this time, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed. Church, would you continue to stand? I'm sorry, I know you sat. We want you to sing this song with us this morning. Our God is an awesome God. He is Hosanna today. When Jesus entered the city, they put the palm branches down on the road. And they said, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is those who's come in the name of the Lord. Amen. We want you to stay standing and sing with us.
See you.
Let's give God the glory that's due his name. If you would raise your hands with me and let's sing Hosanna. Let's sing.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
He is worthy today.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
Praise, let's sing it again.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
He is worthy today. Give him praise and glory. Thank you, Lord, for who you are today. You are Hosanna. You may be seated.
They're busy and they're cheeky, they look so good it's freaky, they come off kinda geeky, the perfect family. Their house is so clean, no one is ever mean, they've even gone green, the perfect family.
Neat, sweet, complete.
They're hanging and they're chilling, they're ready and they're willing, you know you want to kill them, the perfect family.
All right, yeah. What I love is only the second weekend we already have audience participation. That's cool. All right, if you will, turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 12. Let me welcome you to our service. Guys, I tell you what, I wish I'd been here when he was calling your names. This is the best looking graduating class we've had in a year. Y'all are looking good. Yeah, y'all are looking good. I can't believe how old some of your parents are as I'm getting here. These are people that I'm thinking you're still kids, and good gracious. Want to welcome those who are watching on the web, and today we're continuing the series, The Perfect Family. And last week, you remember, we said there are no perfect families. Why aren't there perfect families? Because there are no perfect people, and people make up families. Because we all have the effects of sin and the fall in our lives. So today we understand that there are no perfect parents. In fact, what really kills me, though, is the hit that parents are taking in our culture. It seems like if somebody gets caught in some kind of sin or they do something, the first ones they want to blame is their parents. You know, I just wasn't hugged enough. That's why I did, you know, or my parents never affirmed me enough. And those, we got to remember, Scripture tells us we're to honor our fathers and our mothers. And we can't blame our, now look, some people grew up in some very terrible homes, and I understand that. But here's what Scripture says. When we become believers, God is our Father. And He will be the Father to us that we need. And so, think about this. Our first parents, Adam and Eve, had three boys. One of them was a murderer. Now, if they couldn't get it right, you just got to know we're going to struggle too. And there are no perfect parents. But here's what we need to understand. God does have a perfect plan for parenting. And we're going to look at some of that today as we kind of lay out a parent's responsibility, things that we need to do and the priorities we need to make. In your notes, let's just throw it out on the table. Here's God's perfect plan. God's perfect plan is this, that a parent's job is to move your child from total dependence on you to total dependence on God. If you get that, you've gotten everything. In fact, if it's already sunk in, you can leave now. And no, I'm teasing. That's what it's all about. In fact, I had somebody say, where were you 20 years ago when I was raising my kid? And I said, I was making the same mistakes you were 20 years ago, all right? But I've come to understand this is what parenting is all about. When a baby is born, he is totally dependent on his parents. His parents have to feed him. His parents have to give him protection. His parents have to give him direction. And you know, everything, the parents take care of everything, that baby's life. Our goal then is when they leave the home, when they get old enough to go off to college and leave the home, our goal then is they're no longer depending on us, but they're depending totally on God. See, we have this wrong misconception in our culture that a parent's job is to teach our kids to be independent. No, they're not to be independent. They're to be dependent on God and interdependent on each other. Now, we don't want them dependent on us anymore. My son's about to get married, and guess what? I'm about to get an office, right? Because he ain't coming back home. I mean, I'm taking his bedroom. It's going to be an office. Those days are over. You can sleep on the couch or the guest room or whatever, right? He's no longer dependent on me, but I want him to be dependent on God for his spiritual food. I want him to be dependent on God for direction in life. I want him to be dependent on God for wisdom and decisions that he makes and friends that he makes. And I want him to be interdependent with other believers. You see, it is impossible for you to carry out God's plan for your life in isolation. God created us to live in community with each other as the body of Christ, and we are interdependent on each other in order to live out God's plan in our lives. Romans chapter 12, starting in verse 9, gives us some really great insight into parenting. Now, it goes beyond parenting. There are some great wisdom here for life. There's some great wisdom for our families, but there's also some great wisdom that we find in here for parenting. Let me start in verse 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil and cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need and practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position, and do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, and be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. And what parent hadn't claimed that promise, right? For it is written, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Man, that is just rich. And this week, you might want to just meditate on those verses. There's some deep stuff there. But I see five things for parents that we can find in that to apply to our lives. The first is this, that we need to set a consistent example. Paul said, hate what is evil and cling to what is good. All right, finish this. Don't do as I do as I, right? How many grew up in homes like that, right? Understand this, that doesn't work. Because here's the deal, more is caught than taught. Your kids really don't care what you say, they want to see how you live. It's amazing how kids have this great hypocrisy meter, right? If you say you believe one thing and you live inconsistent to that, they can spot it a mile away. And what kids are looking for is consistency in their parents' lives. And what is that consistency revolving around? For us, we know what it revolves around is seeking first the kingdom of God. Living for him and allowing him to set the priorities in our lives. Understand this. We talked about it last week. What you put first in your life determines what you're becoming. And here's what I want you to understand. And parents, if you have kids at home, I want you to feel the depth of this. What you are determines, for the most part, what your kids are going to be. There's always exceptions to the rule, and God promises he can be the father to the fatherless, and he can change and transform. But just think about this. Like father, like the apple doesn't fall far from the, right? We recognize enough in our culture that we have those colloquialisms that go with that, you know, that we say who we are determines who our kids are. In fact, I remember when I was dating somebody, several people told me this. They said, if you want to know what your wife is going to be like 20 years down the road, look at your mother-in-law. Now, some of you are shaking your boots right now because you didn't know that, right? But it's true, right? It really is true. And they would say, look, if you wouldn't marry the mother-in-law, don't marry the woman, because that's probably who she's going to become. And we understand that who we are shapes and molds who our kids are going to be. And we need to set a consistent, godly example for our kids. I mean, we even know this to be true to this extent, that kids who grow up in a divorced home are more likely to get divorced. Kids who grow up in a home of alcohol or chemical abuse are more likely to abuse alcohol or chemicals. So why is it that we need to take parenting seriously? Because who you are has a huge effect on who your kids are going to be. And we need to set a consistent example of what it means to live for the Lord and to follow Him passionately. Two things I want to challenge every parent in the room, and that is this. Number one, keep your promises. Man, there is nothing that will destroy a kid's spirit more than to promise one thing and not deliver. And Seth hated this, but growing up, he would say, can I, can we? And my answer was, we'll see. It was vague enough, I wasn't promising anything, right? And so I'd say, we'll see, and he goes, in other words, I got to ask you again in a couple days, right? Yeah. Don't break your promises. And then secondly, apologize when you're wrong. You say, well, I'm the parent. He's supposed to do what I say. All right, look, apologize when you're wrong. Because here's something we need to understand. There is no way you can walk in intimacy with the Lord without acknowledging your sins daily, right? We go and say, God, I blew this, and forgive me. And in that, we see God's grace and His mercy. When we admit to our kids in an age-appropriate way that we've blown it, I lost my temper, I shouldn't have done that, or I should have done that, when we acknowledge that, it teaches them that nobody's perfect, and that in the same way God extends mercy to us, we want them to extend mercy to us, and we extend mercy to them, and it teaches them to go to God and ask for forgiveness. So be a consistent example. Number two, put relationship ahead of rules. Romans 9 says, love must be sincere, be devoted to one another. Circle that word, devoted. And here's what I want you to understand. It takes time to build devotion. Devotion doesn't happen overnight. If you want to be devoted to the Lord, that takes time. It takes time every day in His Word. It takes time in prayer. It takes time in worship and Bible study. True, deep devotion to the Lord doesn't happen overnight. It takes time. Same thing in your marriage. You aren't devoted to your spouse right away. That's why God gave us hormones, all right? And when the hormones start, that's when the devotion kicks in, right? That takes time to build those deep relationships. And you can't be devoted if you don't spend time together. Same thing with our kids. We need to spend time with them so we can build into their lives. Building devotion takes time. George Barna wrote in his latest book, he said, a century ago, parents spent 58% of their waking hours with their kids. Now, some of y'all think that's a nightmare, but that's what it was, right? A century ago, almost 60% of your waking time was with your kids. You know what? You can build devotion in your kids' lives that way. Guess what it is today? 18%. 18% of our time is with our kids. Why? Because we have iPods and iPads. We have our Fab Five. We have MP3s. We have, Xbox. We have the Wii. We have high def. We have all of those distractions in our lives. And because of that, only 18% of our time is spent with our kids. In fact, for teenagers, parents spend an average of 14 minutes a day with their teenager. And we wonder why teenagers rebel. You cannot build devotion on 14 minutes a day. And as parents, it's our job to limit some of the distractions. I got to admit, I admire the homes that I go into and they don't have a TV. There's actually those homes out there. I don't think I could survive, but I admire those homes, right? Because they're saying, look, we're going to make family a priority. And we don't have to all be that drastic, but we do have to make time to be devoted to our kids. We need to build that time in for our kids. One of the reasons that many are not devoted is because they're in debt and they're financially, they're turned over. And one of the things we need to do, and we teach this all the time, if you're in debt and you have to have a two-income household to pay the bills, you need to figure out a way to get out of debt so that money is not driving your household. I had one of our deacons, guy in a church, come to me a couple years ago and said, Chuck, I was offered a job that basically was going to double my salary. He said, but it was going to keep me away from home 3 or 4 nights a week, so I turned it down. And my response to him was, way to go. Because let me tell you this, God is not impressed by the size of our homes. God is impressed by the size of our hearts toward him and our heart towards others, especially our spouse and our kids and our home. And God has blessed that in his family. You may want to write this down. Discipline without devotion is destructive. Discipline without devotion is destructive. Another way of saying it is this: rules without relationship leads to rebellion. If you have kids that are rebelling, if they're walking away from you, if they're walking away from God, if they're rebelling at everything that you say, the first thing you need to ask yourself, how devoted am I to my child? Am I trying to put rules in there without a relationship? And we need to make sure that we take the time to build those relationships in our homes. Otherwise, your discipline will be destructive. The third thing I see is this. We need to live life with passion. Live life with passion. Verse 11 of chapter 12. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Heard about a lady who just graduated in college, and she went to a fortune teller and wanted to know what her life was going to be like. So she went to the fortune teller and said, tell me what my life is going to be like. The fortune teller said, well, ma'am, I'm sorry. I have bad news for you. He said, you're going to be poor and unhappy until you're 37 years old. And she was taken aback, and then she thought, okay, well, what happens when I get 37? Am I going to be rich? And the fortune teller said, no, you're still going to be poor, but you'll just be used to it by then, all right? And here's the truth. There are people who are existing who really aren't living. And who we are determines who our kids are going to be. And Paul says, man, never be lacking with zeal or passion or excitement in your life. Keep your spiritual fervor going. You know, as Christians, we're on the greatest adventure known to man. There is no reason why there shouldn't be a passion in our lives and a zeal in our lives as we serve the Lord. Because as we serve the Lord, here's what we understand. We understand our job is not just something we go to in order to pay the bills. It's a way that we serve the Lord through our job. We have a good work ethic. We honor God through our work. We understand our marriage is much more than just a marriage. It's one of the ways we honor God and serve the Lord. Scripture tells us this, whatever you do in word or deed, do it all as unto the Lord. And God wants everything we do. If we have a golf game, he wants to do that unto the Lord. If we enjoy a hobby, do that unto the Lord. Raising our kids, we're doing that unto the Lord. Because Scripture says, whatever you do in word or deed. I looked up that Greek word, whatever, and you'd be amazed. You know what it means? Whatever. It means anything, everything that you do with this bent, with this slant, that it's as unto the Lord. So I'm going to be a husband in a way that honors my wife, but also honors God. I want to have a work ethic that honors God, that people look and say, man, that is something that honors God. I want to live my life in a way that everything I do brings honor and glory to God. And that creates this incredible passion in our lives. Last week we talked about in our homes we're to build an atmosphere of love, joy, grace, expectancy, passion. We should have that zeal. Spurgeon said this. Spurgeon said, people are looking for people of passion. He said, set yourself on fire and people will come and watch you burn. And let me tell you what, if we are on fire for the Lord, people will be drawn to that. They'll want to know how in the why in the world that that we live the way that we do. You know, I've had people say, all right, Chuck, this going back and forth, like, how long is that going to happen? And can you keep that up? And we're praying for you. I got to tell you, I am more relaxed and more wired right now. I mean, more relaxed and more pumped right now than I was a month ago. Why? Because this is, yeah. Because God's using me in a different way. And let me tell you, I just got back from our 535 camps. Awesome worship service. We baptized three. I got to tell you this. We're going to go a little late, but I got to tell you this story. They baptized before, but they borrowed a baptistry to do that because there's no baptistry in the church. And we called the church we borrowed it from before, and they couldn't find it, so we didn't have a baptistry. So guess what I did Friday afternoon? I went to Winter Garden Feed and Seed and bought a feed trough. All right. We set it up, we filled it with water, we heated the water, we put plants in front of it so it looks really good and all that. So I just baptized three people in a feed trough at 535. We had a great time. Yeah. Look, there should be incredible passion in everything that we do. You know, and again, it talks about our heart, that our heart should be on, you know, excited about what we're doing. Number four, the fourth thing I see here is this: understand the power of prayer. Notice as Paul goes on, he says, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Never underestimate the power of prayer. Some of you are sitting here this morning and your child's up here and you know they're about to leave home. Some of you, you feel like your child is prepared and ready to go. Some, you're wondering how long before your child comes back home, right? Or all of those kind of things. But here's the deal. We don't quit praying because they leave home. We pray for them. Some of you are grandparents. You should be praying for your kids and for your grandkids daily. In Luke chapter 5, we read the story of four guys who had a friend who was a paralytic. And they heard Jesus was in town teaching and healing, and he was at a house. And so these four guys got together, and they went and got the paralytic, and they put him on a mat, and they carried him to the house, hoping that maybe Jesus would heal him. When they got to the house was so jam-packed, full of people, that they couldn't get in. But these four guys weren't going to give up, so they went up on the roof, and they cut a hole through the roof. Now imagine you're the owner of the house, and somebody's put in a skylight you didn't order, okay? I mean, the mud's starting to fall. All of a sudden, you got this new skylight in your house. And they lowered this paralytic through the hole in the roof in front of Jesus. Now, you know the story. You know the paralytic was healed. But don't miss why he was healed. Yeah, Jesus looked at the paralytic. He had compassion on the paralytic. But here's what happened. Jesus looked up at that skylight, and he looked at the four guys standing up there looking down through the holes, their face lit up with joy because they've gotten their friend in front of Jesus. And here's what Jesus said. Because of your faith, I'm going to heal this guy. I hope you feel the power of that. It's because of the faith of the four that the paralytic was healed. So what does that mean? That means I have the ability to change other people's lives through my prayer and actions. And I can intercede for other people. Some of you are here because you had a grandmother that prayed for you daily. When you were off chasing things of the world, she was faithful to continue to pray for you. Or a mother. And the only reason you're here is because they constantly interceded for you. And God honored their faith, not yours. And what we need to understand, some of you in here, I know you've got children who are prodigals right now. They're off trying the things of this world because you put them on the prayer list. I pray for them every week. Some of you are here, and you're not really sure what your kids are up to. Man, they're out of the house, and maybe like last week, they're good kids, but they just don't have any passion for the Lord. Well, don't underestimate the power of prayer. You know, for 22 years, I've been praying for my oldest son's wife. I just didn't know who she was until about 6 months ago, all right? But we in our house, we've prayed for his wife. And you know what? God honored those prayers. And he's going to marry a girl who's in this church, and today she's in Swaziland on a mission trip. And we praise the Lord. In fact, last night I thanked her mom and dad because they come on Saturday night. And I thanked them for the job that they did. And never underestimate the power of prayer when we talk about raising our kids. And then lastly, number five, do not let your current circumstances cause you to lose hope. Notice how Paul finishes this section. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Look, I know some people are going through some really tough times right now. Some, it's around your kids and what's going on in their lives, and you stay up late at night praying for them and concerned about them. For others, it's a marriage issue and not even sure if it's going to work out. For some, it's a job-related issue. Their unemployment's still close to 12%. For some, it's an economic issue, and are we going to be able to stay in the home, or what's going to happen there? And here's what I want you to understand. Paul says, man, don't lose hope in that, and don't let fear rule in that. And let me tell you, as parents, here's the principle. When tough times come, your kids are looking to you to see how you're going to respond. Are you going to respond in fear, or are you going to respond in faith? So when something happens and you immediately fall apart and have all this fear, they're going to ask the question, well, where does God fit into the equation? You keep talking about the fact that he's bigger than all our problems, then why aren't you living that? But if when the tough times come, if you then walk by faith instead of fear, you're able to teach your kids, you know what? We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but we know who's in charge of tomorrow. And we're going to be faithful every day. And it's an incredible opportunity to teach our kids. So where do we start? In your notes, how do I start? And here's what I want us to understand. Your kids don't need a perfect parent. What they need is a parent that they see God is changing them. And he'll understand if he changes mom and dad, he can change them. So as parents, what do we do? Number one, give your heart fully to God. Because you cannot pass on what you don't have. Same as last week, seek first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. Well, look at what Deuteronomy says. These commands I give you today are to be upon your hearts first. And then you impress them on your children. And what will happen if we do that? Look at the second. He will turn your heart toward home. Malachi 4:6 is the very last verse in the Old Testament. And here's what it says. If we make God a priority, if we're passionate about our relationship with God, he will set our priorities straight, and our priorities will be that he will be first, but then our family will be next. And he'll turn our family, our hearts toward our homes. Our homes will be more important than our work. Our homes will be more important than a round of golf. Our homes will be more important than those other distractions. And then he will honor that by turning the hearts of our children back to us. Let's pray together. God, I know in a room with this many people that, Lord, there are parents and grandparents here that, God, are in all different stages. There are some here that are just praising you for children who are following closely and they're following you. And Lord, there are other parents who are grieving right now because of kids who are doing the prodigal thing. And Lord, you know where each one of us are. And God, for some in this room right now, the only step is prayer, because everything else is out of their control. But Lord, they can still put you first and set an example. Father, for others, it's going to mean mom and dad being consistent in their parenting. It may mean, Lord, for some to learn to walk more by faith and not by fear. God, you do have a perfect plan for parenting. Lord, give us the faith to follow and to obey what you've laid out for us. For your glory, in Jesus' name, amen.
I want to give a little insight to the kids of what's going on in a parent's mind. There's this tape that's playing, and it's playing over and over again, and sometimes the volume's turned up kind of loud. Sometimes it's a little more subtle background music. But the tape that keeps playing, kids, inside of your parents' mind is I failed in some way. I haven't done everything I could to be the perfect parent. And let me tell you, it doesn't matter how good the kids turn out or anything. It's just there. It's there all the time. We hear a sermon like this, and immediately we think, I failed there. I failed there. I did okay there, but I failed there. But it's okay, because they're not perfect. Through a sermon like this is an opportunity for us to say, yes, I've examined the things of my heart. I know what the Bible has to say. And now what do I do with it? Do I just take it as a sermon and say, okay, those are 5 points. I'll put them down. I'll tuck them inside of my Bible. Or am I going to do something about it? So parents, if you're a parent right now, if you're either actively parenting or maybe you're pregnant with your first child or your kids have gone off, whatever it might be, if you're a parent, could you stand right now? Parents, it's tough. It's tough. We know. It's hard. We know. But let's pray. Father, so many parents here representing so many stages of life. If they're newborns, they have newborns in their house. Praise God, because they have an opportunity to take this information and apply it to their lives. If they have children in the house and a little more grown up, it's never too late, is it, Lord, to bring your truth, to bring to bring honesty to the relationship, to even apologize for some of the things they've done that have fallen short. And even for those whose kids have moved on, that are out of the house, it's a great time to be a parent, to be a grandparent, and show them the way that you want them to live as they have moved out of the house. So I pray for the single parents that are here, who are trying to do all of this by themselves, and that you would give them the strength to do double duty, that you would step in as the heavenly parent, greater than before, and work on their families. Help them through this time. For those that are grieving of a loss of a child, this is a difficult time and a difficult time to hear this. And Lord, we just have to know that we've done our best. And we know there's always room for improvement. And we pray this in your name. Amen. You can be seated. We want to open up our altar for a time of prayer. There's a lot of different things that we could do during response time. It's appropriate that the song is Breakthrough. And there are some relationships that really need a breakthrough. And some of it may be two parents saying, you know what, I want to come up and I'm going to pray for my kids during this time. I want you to break through there. You may also say, hey, I want to take my child. Maybe I want to bring my child up. And we want to pray for some of the things that are going on in their life. And just a time of breakthrough there. Finally, for you kids, this might be a great time for you to come up and pray for your parents, because you know some of the struggles that they're going through. You know they're not perfect, but still, you can go to your perfect heavenly Father, who is always willing to hear your cries. So let's stand. And during this time, let's praise God. And let's pray for him also.
Breakthrough.
as people continue to pray, we don't want to interrupt that, but as you continue to pray, we just want to pray. Father, first of all, we start with just a confession. We confess as parents, we've dropped the ball. We have not been the example of the perfect parent that you have given to us. So in repentance, we come to you. Lord, in humility, we come to you and we say, Lord, show us a better way. How do we do it? What can we do in this situation? God, we ask that you'd be the Heavenly Father to the orphans, to those that are straying, that are gone, that are lost, that are out on their own, the prodigals. God, continue to work on their heart and bring them back home. First of all, bring them back home to you. Bring them back home to you, Lord. And then bring them back home to the parents. Their hearts need to be right first. It's the whole story of the prodigal son. Father, during this time, I know you're going to honor these prayers, and you've heard them. You know the situations, and you're going to bless them. We ask that you continue to work in us. Continue to work through the series, and we pray in your name. Amen. We're going to take our offering now. Carl, if you want to pray for us.
Please be seated. Please pray with me. Dear Father, our Lord, our God, thank you, dear Father, for being our God and letting us, through our Lord Jesus, be your children. Dear Father, we know that all of our resources come from you, and we thank you, dear Father, for this privilege to return a portion back to you. Thank you, dear Father, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
See you.
I took my shoes off. I thought this was holy ground. Wait, come over here. Come over here. Oh, you disappointed me. You know, we're talking about perfect parenting. Tell me why you wrote that song.
I wrote that song because, when my mom got cancer and just went down to the hospital for 2 weeks to get the tumor removed, I just had all these really emotions, like, I didn't really know how to express them or anything like that, and God knew it was on my heart, and so I wrote the song because God really wrote the song. I didn't really write it. He just knew it was on my heart, so he was just like, oh, here you go. There you go. So it's on your heart.
All right, there might not be any perfect parents, but it sounds like Ron and Jenny are pretty close, right?
Yeah.
All right, thanks. Now on with baptism.
And again, what an awesome weekend to be able to baptize, especially those two that I'm going to have the privilege of baptizing this morning, because I know their parents, and I know that their parents love the Lord and are walking with the Lord and doing everything they can to have children who that legacy is passed on through. This is Alex Kojic, and Alex not only has mom and dad coming here, but he has grandparents who come here, and he's got a legacy of those who love the Lord and walk with the Lord that are being passed down to him. Alex, this morning, do you know that Jesus lives in your heart? Alex, because you've confessed with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, it's my privilege to be able to baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. This is Rachel. Rachel led us in worship just a little while ago. Rachel accepted Christ at a very early age, but she's coming now to follow through with that step of baptism and that act of obedience. Do you know that in the Bible, this is your public profession of faith? It's not walking down an aisle on Sunday morning. It's to be baptized, and that's sharing with the world and with her church family that Jesus lives in her heart. And Rachel, do you know that you're a believer this morning?
Yes.
Rachel, because you've confessed with your mouth the Lord Jesus, you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. It's my privilege to be able to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. As if all of that is not enough, our graduating seniors, the special song baptism, we have a team that's leaving for Brazil this week. And so with those who are going to Brazil, please come up front. I know Coco's one of those, the Santini family, I don't know if they're here, others who are going to Brazil, if you would come forward. And we want to pray for these who are going out. Pray for God's protection. Pray that God uses them in a mighty way. And Troy is going to commission them as he closes us in prayer.
Now, there are a number of people here over time that have supported missions. If you're someone that has gone on a mission trip, could you stand? You've been on a mission trip with this church, with any other church? That's great. Now, if in any way you have supported financially a missionary as they went out, could you stand? If at any time you have prayed for a missionary while they have been out on a mission trip, could you stand? All right, that's pretty good prayer support, wouldn't you say? Wouldn't you say? Uh-oh.
I have to say, this is our 25th anniversary, myself and my wife, not today, but this year. This is the 10th anniversary that I first went in a mission trip to Brazil, 2010. I may be speak wrong. I may be speak not the right verb. And I may speak with a little accent. But you know what? God speaks through me, through my heart, to you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your support. I see you all guys in heaven just reaping the harvest that you are sowing right now.
You know, earlier we talked about passion and zeal. I think you see it right here. So let's pray for them as they head out to Brazil and do a mighty work. Father, go with this team. You have assembled this team. This is the right people, the right time, and at the right place. And everywhere they go, there'll be a confirmation that they needed to be there. As they go as a small group, but they go as a larger group. We go with them with our prayer and our support. Your angels go with them, watching over them, everything they do. And most of all, God, you are with them, directing their paths, bringing people to them who are lost, and increasing the attendance in the heaven that final day because of the work that they are doing and we are doing as a church to support them. We pray this in your name. Amen. One other announcement. If you want to be a part of this church and you're excited about some of the things that are going on, the Discovery Church membership class is happening right after this service in our common grounds. Stop in there. If you say, oh, I didn't make a reservation, that's fine. You just come on in. We'll take care of you. And we want to show you some of the things that are going on in this church. And seniors, this was awesome. They're now going to their lunch, and you're dismissed.